Shalom, welcome to the Jewish View. My name is Rabbi Nachman Simon with the Chabados of Dahmer, together with my co-host Mark Gronich of jbiztechvalley.com and Statewide News Service.
Well, Rabbi, we have today with us a guest that has the foremost authority in the Middle East, in my opinion, and it's Stephen Berk from Union College with the Henry and Sally Schaffer Professor of Holocaust and Jewish Studies. Welcome to the Jewish View.
It's a pleasure and privilege to be here.
So we want to get your thoughts on the Middle East as it relates to the surrounding countries and how they relate to Israel and, you know, and how it got to this point. So with, yeah, you know, the British,
the history, really,
with the
maybe.
British mandate and all the way.
Well, maybe it goes
through.
Even earlier that you're starting 100 years ago and,
you know,
maybe well, you'd have to go through a whole history course of thousands of years ago.
Well, I could let you start where you want
let
to start.
Let me begin by saying, using a statement that I wish I had coined, but I did not. The statement is, Israel is a good country in a bad neighborhood. And the neighborhood has always been hostile and even more hostile today than it really has been in the past. Where should one begin? Jerusalem, Jerusalem, if I forget thee, let my right hand forget its cunning, let my tongue cleave to the roof of my mouth. The Jews in Babylonia longed to return home. The Jewish people instituted in their religion, in their thinking, in their worldview, a memory of the promised land. Again, I know to whom I'm speaking here, and so it's a little awkward, but we are on television
yes.
here. We don't pray towards Miami, we pray towards Jerusalem. When we bench or say the grace, the prayer after the meals, we pray for the peace of Jerusalem, dew and rain in Jerusalem. So there was always a longing for that. The transformation takes place in the 19th century, okay. when a number of things occurred, one very unfortunate. That is the rapid growth of a very, very harsh anti-Semitism. That is pogroms in Russia, a very hostile rhetoric towards Jews in Western and Central Europe. Again, the Jews are a misfortune, Judenunze Unglück. In Russian, Bejidov spasai Rossiyu, beat the kikes and save Russia. This anti-Semitism, and in fact, the very term anti-Semitism, occurs really at the end of the 19th century. For 1900 years, Christians would say, see that Jewish kid crossing the street? Let's beat the living daylights out of him because his ancestors killed Jesus. Comes the new racial anti-Semitism. The Jewish kid crosses the street, let's kill him. Because the evil of the Jew is not in his Torah, it's not in his Talmud, it's in his blood. Or what we would say, his genes and his chromosomes. This anti-Semitism led a number of Jews, Herzl is the most famous, but he's not the only one, Pinsker earlier in Russia, Hess earlier in the German lands, had come to the conclusion that the Jews had exhausted their possibilities in Europe. It's time to get out. We've got to get out. In addition to that, there was the success of nationalism in Europe. The Italians get Italy. The Germans get Germany. The Ukrainians want the Ukraine. They will not get it. Still, it's a matter of course whether they're really going to get it. But they wanted it. These nationalist movements led Hess as early as the early 1860s to say, in effect, it's over for us here. If the Italians can get Italy and Rome is their capital, why can't the Jews have the ancient homeland, Israel, Palestine, and Jerusalem as their capital? So the combination of anti-Semitism and the nationalism and the acculturation of Jews. Jews became, not more, they became familiar with the indigenous languages. They knew about nationalism. They knew about, well, they knew about the anti-Semitism. This is going to lead to the creation of a Zionist movement.
Okay, so why that specific plot of land? If you're saying Israel's a good nation, a bad neighborhood, why not just move to a better neighborhood? Why does it have to be that plot of land?
There were people who said that. You're absolutely right, Mark. There were people who said, let's go to Arizona. Let's go to Australia. There were people who said that. But again, and even Herzl, appalled after the Kishinev pogrom in 1903, Herzl said, we'll never forget the dream of going to the ancient homeland, and eventually we will get there. But we've got to have a place where a Jewish mother can rest comfortably knowing that someone will not put an ice pick through her son's brain. So maybe we ought to go to Kenya Uganda, places like that. But the heartland of the Jews was always Eastern Europe. And even for secular Jews, for religious Jews, again, we get into a sticky thing here. Most religious Jews, most what we would call Orthodox Jews, repudiated Zionism. And they would do so until the Second World War. But for less Orthodox Jews, and secular people, there was only one place to go. And that was the ancient homeland.
Why is that, why that piece of land carved out that way? I mean, we're finding Noah's Ark was in what's now in a different country. You know, we're finding other artifacts that are located in other...
Artifacts, Mark.
Right.
The ancient homeland is the homeland of David and Solomon. It's the homeland of the prophets. It's the homeland of the two temples. It's the place where the Jewish people entered history and made these remarkable contributions to history. And even secular people believed this is the place to go. Okay. The other argument was, of course, along with this, was where else are we going to go? Wherever we go, it's the same thing. It's going to be a repetition of the anti-Semitism and the assimilation. So we've got to have a homeland for ourselves.
So
now, you want to take the long view. Herzl was a secular man. The Zionist movement created by Herzl was by and large secular.
Mm-hmm.
Into this are going to come some other people. One, some rabbis, mm-hmm. some Orthodox rabbis broke with the mainstream and said, this is the dawn of our redemption. Mm. We've got to go there. But when they said, we're going to go to Eretz Yisrael, the country that we're going to build is a country based on halakha, on Jewish law.
Mm-hmm.
But also into the movement, in larger numbers, came people who are, secular doesn't even begin to describe it. These were highly secular, assimilated people, but they retained their sense of Jewishness. And many of them were socialists.
Mm-hmm.
Many of them were Marxists.
Mm-hmm.
And they said, when we get to the Jewish homeland, no halakha. We're going to create a Jewish homeland based upon secular and socialist principles. Now, here's what they didn't teach you in the yeshiva. And here's what they don't teach in the Hebrew schools. Some of those chalutzim hop from bed to bed. Sexual fidelity, that's a bourgeois concept, they said. Some of those first settlements raised pigs and ate pork.
Mm-hmm.
They were breaking with the old ways. Now, to deal with so many subjects here, that is a problem that has continued down to the present day.
Right.
What kind of a Jewish state is this going
that's
to be?
That's what I'm asking about, exactly.
That's it. I tell the students the first day of every class, you cannot explain the present by the present. Everything has a past. This
right.
is the past. Why is it that they throw rocks at people in B'nai Brak, will throw rocks at people who drive through the streets? Well, this is a conflict that goes back to the end of the 19th century. What kind of a country is this going to be? Now, in addition to that, of course, there was something that some Zionists, not Herzl, Herzl was a smart man, and he was an observant in the sense that he knew what was happening. You want to hear one of the dumbest statements that was ever made?
Sure.
This is really dumb. The people without a land is going to the land without a people. At that time, there were 500,000 Arabs in Palestine. That becomes the second problem. How do you deal with these people who are not Jewish, who see the land as theirs, and have been there for a very, very long time? To really cut to the chase, the genius of the Zionist movement was that most, not all, but most Zionist leaders said, we'll take half of a loaf of bread.
Better than none.
Better than none.
Mm-hmm.
The tragedy of the Arabs has been a position, it's all ours. Every single inch of this is ours, and we will not give up a single inch of this land. That's the tragedy of the Arabs. Now, what Herzl could not achieve was achieved during World War I, and that is, We may curse the British from today until doomsday. They did some nasty things later on. They restricted Jewish immigration to Palestine while the Jews were fleeing the Nazis. They tilted towards the Arabs in 47 and 48. But there is no question, virtually every historian has to concede the point. Without the Balfour Declaration of November 2nd of 1917, there would never have been a Jewish state in 1948. Herzl could never get the support of a great power to support Zionism. But because of certain circumstances in World War I, the second greatest lobbyist in Jewish history, Chaim Weizmann, was able to persuade the British, and they had their British had their own reasons.
Sure.
Now, for the audience and ourselves, but who's the greatest lobbyist in Jewish history? Moshe Rabbeinu, right? He's the greatest. But second is Chaim Weizmann. So Weizmann, again.
But the Balfour Declaration wasn't just because of a love for the Jewish people.
Yes, you're absolutely right. Some of it actually was. Balfour, in his diaries, makes reference to the fact that the Jews have been treated horribly by Christians over the centuries. This is one of the ways that we can set things right. But you are absolutely correct. National interest was the determining factor. In World War I, the British, up against the wall, exaggerate the role of Jews in the United States and in the new Soviet state, and believe that if you do something for the Jews, the Jews in America will push them, will make America come into the war, and the Jews in Russia will keep Russia in the war. And the British also believe, do something for the Jews, give them a Jewish homeland when the war is over, and when we divvy up the Ottoman Empire, the influential Jews and the wealthy Jews, the British exaggerated Jewish wealth and influence, that these Jews will support our claims in the Middle East. But the problem is going to be the problem that continues down to the present day. The Arab rejection of Jewish settlement in that land.
So there were Jewish settlements, just to be clear, not only from the 1900s, they were a lot earlier. So maybe, like you're saying, I'm not disputing your facts, 500,000 Arabs were there, but there was always a Jewish presence.
There was always a Jewish presence, and for probably 100 years, going back to the middle of the 19th century, there probably was a Jewish majority in Jerusalem. There were always Jews that were there. But in terms of the population, really the overwhelming majority of the population was Arab. Now the Jews are coming in, the British are supporting this, and the Arabs have a problem.
I have a question that goes from one end of the timeline spectrum to the present day. But in the very, when you read the Torah, it says that this is the Jewish homeland, Israel, and that this is our homeland. And we, you know, this is where we have to go. But the Canaanites were already there. And why would Hashem want us to kick out someone else when there was so much vacant land? This is before the first temple, the second temple, all the temple. You know, why would we have to kick someone else out in order to satisfy our own
nationalism?
All right. Now, that's a very good question, Mark. I don't want to poach on the rabbi's territory here.
No, you're not.
But the Torah also makes clear, remember, that God, Hashem, is allowing the land to spew these people out because of their abominable practices, their beliefs, and what they did. Child sacrifice, for example. Sexual orgies, for example. The land is going to spew them out. And the warning to the Jews, to the Hebrews, they're not called Jews at that time, or the Israelites, the warning there is, watch out. I mean, the blessings and the curses. I mean, I don't mean to poach on the rabbi's territory here. It's very clear. You emulate the people of Canaan, you're out of here too. And why do they have to go? Well, because they will act as a magnet, attracting your people. So, for example, the incidents in the Torah, Baal Peor, for example, where some of the Canaanites, people living in Canaan, some of the women seduce sexually the Israelite men. Now, again, I'm not the one to talk whether this is right, whether this is wrong, or so on. The only thing I can tell you is, despite what the Torah says, we do know that these people are not kicked out, and that they're not murdered or exterminated. And how do we know that? Because centuries later, the prophets are still telling us that you are resorting to some of the practices of the people who are living here.
The Canaanites.
The Canaanites. They're not called, they're called by different names and so on.
Okay.
But going back to what we were talking about, the Arabs are going to resist Jewish immigration for a number of reasons. One, of course, is whose land is this? In an age of nationalism, the Arabs, it's ours. It's not theirs. Second is the religious issue. In the eyes of Islam, the Jews are dhimmis. They are a protected people. Their religion is legitimate, but it is inferior to Islam. Therefore, the idea that Jews should exercise sovereignty over Muslims and over land that Muslims consider to be holy to Islam is inconceivable. Now, every analogy is a reach. I'm going to give you one. It's a reach. Herzl goes to Rome to talk to people in the Vatican, and he hears a sympathetic response. A sympathetic response. The Jews have suffered, they're entitled to a land. And then one individual, highly placed in the church, says to Herzl, in effect, this is not verbatim, you have a point, Herzl, you have a point, the Jews have suffered. But how can we allow you, the people who killed Jesus, how can we allow you to have control over Bethlehem, over Nazareth, over Jerusalem itself, all of those places that are holy to Christendom? That's the problem. It is true. One ought never to dispute this. It was far better to be a Jew living under Islam for many centuries than it was a Jew living under Christendom. That is true. But even in those good times, there were difficulties. And the problem is, and I think it's a problem that exists down to the present day, who the devil, I think Muslims are saying, some of them, who the devil do you think you are? Mm-hmm. Your religion is inferior, it's legitimate. Remember, Islam says that Judaism and Jews and Christians got divinely revealed books. The Torah is divinely revealed, says Islam, and so is the New Testament. But you screwed them up. What did the Christians do? According to Islam, they took a great prophet, Jesus, and they turned him into a son of God, a violation of monotheism. What did the Jews do? Well, they did a number of things. They cursed the prophets, says Islam, and the anthropomorphisms of the Torah. God is angry. God smites with his right hand. His nostrils flare. That's a violation, says Islam, a violation of monotheism. You're attributing human characteristics to God. The Jewish response, of course, is the Torah has to speak in a language that people understand. So the point here is it's a religious conflict,
mm-hmm.
it's a national conflict, and it's a cultural conflict.
That's right.
Now, the cultural conflict is a very interesting one. Just give me a minute here.
Please, go ahead.
It's this one. If we were in Europe, it's 1900, and we're all on the left, let's say, and I'm your instructor, your Marxist instructor, and I said to you, comrades, comes the revolution, we're going to free the most oppressed people in the world. And then I say, who are the most oppressed people? Well, the workers, proletariat, certainly that's a good answer. Black people, Marxism and Zionism were very sympathetic to the plight of blacks in Africa and blacks in the United States. But who are the most oppressed people in the world? Women. Women are the most oppressed. Why are they oppressed? Well, we men marry them. We turn them into baby makers, sexual slaves, and to domestic workers. Comes the revolution, we're going to free women. Well, some of those Chalutzim who are going to come to Palestine, they will free women. They really will, I said before. Some of them will hop from bed to bed. Woman wants a divorce, boom, gets a divorce. Sexual freedom, sexual freedom. The women dress like men. The women carry guns. The women do God duty. The Arabs always knew. The rabbi is correct. There were lots of Jews. There were thousands of Jews living in Palestine long before the Zionist movement. They had long beards. They were religious people. They observed Shabbat. They observed Kashrut, most of them. And their women were modestly dressed, much like Arab women. Comes the Zionist movement, particularly the left wing of the Zionist movement, Women now occupy a different role, and now there's a cultural reason for despising the Jews. So take it all together, religion, mm-hmm. nationalism, mm-hmm. and cultural reasons, one is going to find a great deal of hostility directed towards the Jews. And it manifests itself, of course, in that crucial year of 1948.
But wow. Take it to the modern day, unfortunately. I mean, it's not just animosity, it's an outright hatred. I mean, you know, just an unsightly, and then really to the Western world also. I mean, it's not only to the Jews, they hate the United States
That's correct.
As much.
That's correct. There's hatred towards modernity on the part of some of these people, hatred towards the Western world, frustration with their lot in life, and a belief on the part of many of them, particularly in the extremist organizations, that the only way to achieve our goals, to make the Arab people great again, to make Muslims great again, is to go back to the original time, the 7th century, the time of Muhammad, the time of the Quran, for example. And this presents some problems, because the Quran has some very nice things to say about Jews on occasion, but some very hostile things to say about Jews. And then there is the Hadith, the sayings and the practices of the Prophet Muhammad. Even Muslim scholars debate as to whether or not Muhammad was really saying all of these things that are to be found in the collections of the Hadith. But there's one Hadith, there's mm-hmm. one of these sayings that is now used all the time by Hamas, by Islamic Jihad, by Hezbollah, and by some very, I would say, extremist clerics, even in Egypt, even those connected to Al-Aqsa, the Harvard of Sunni Islam. The Hadith reader runs something like this. On Judgment Day, the rock will say to the Muslim, Muslim, there's a Jew hiding behind me, kill him. On Judgment Day, the tree will say to the Muslim, Muslim, there's a Jew hiding behind me, kill him. Now, every religion, including Judaism, has in its writings some hostility directed towards people who are non-Jews. But you're hard-pressed today to find someone who goes on television and says makes racial slurs against non-Jews. The Israeli government will not tolerate it. Not tolerate it. Now, again, Rabbi Kahana, for example, Rabbi Kahana and his movement will be castigated by the Israelis. Party will not be allowed to participate in elections. I happen to think that he wasn't a racist, but the Israelis thought he was a racist. Israel is very, very sensitive to this.
He's been up to the University at Albany campus when I was a student.
Yeah.
I had a chance to interview him several times. It was amazing.
He was a very articulate speaker.
Yeah.
He got carried away at times, and that's what really got people against him. And the fact that some of his followers resorted to violence,
right. That
also antagonized people. But you'll never see on Israeli television a rabbi or anybody talking the way Islamic clerics talk about the Jews. Last month, an Islamic cleric got on Egyptian television and was asked about this, about this particular statement about on Judgment Day what's going to happen. He said, absolutely true, that's what's going to happen. And the interviewer asked him, do you mean on Judgment Day the rock is actually going to talk? He said, yes. The tree is going to actually say, be able to speak? He says, absolutely yes. And on Judgment Day, all the Jews will die. Now, what is happening here is a national and cultural conflict, particularly a national conflict, takes on a religious dimension. Those who are most vehemently opposed to Israel will draw on their religious traditions to justify their opposition.
Wow. I've always been curious about these bombs that ISIS and Hamas have been aiming at Israel. Why do you think that, and I know you're not a prophet, you're only a historian, but that they're not aiming it at the big, like the Western Wall? Why are they not aiming it at structures that would really cause a lot of hurt, more so than killing people.
Killing people elicits a reaction. Everybody knows you're there. Everybody knows you're there if you kill people. Besides, blowing up the wall or blowing up some of these, let's say, holy places.
Right. Structures.
Yeah. Structures antagonizes a good part of the world, and I'll get to cut right to it. Kill people, you weaken your enemy. Uh-huh. That's what it really does. You blow up the wall, well, you rebuild the wall. You blow up this place, you rebuild. You can't bring back the dead. And that's really the issue. You want to hurt these people. You hate them.
I thought there might have been some religious reasons why they wouldn't, whether they think that, okay, you know, like they blew up the World Trade Center, you know, if you blow up the Western Wall, maybe that's going to be the trigger that the United States needs to go in there and really...
Well, blowing up 9/11 is the trigger. I mean, if they blew up the Statue of Liberty, Americans would be incensed, absolutely incensed. Would it justify an invasion of Afghanistan? I'm not sure. Kill 3,100 Americans?
Right.
That's a different story.
Gotcha.
You know, just even though you keep on saying not a prophet, but I know from history you're supposed to learn about how to deal with the present situation. What do you see for the Middle East? I mean, again, I know you're not a prophet, but I mean, if you would be in the Washington diplomatic corps, I mean, they have to have that question. They have to deal with it, or the Israeli situation. How are we going to deal with, you know, we want peace. Israelis in Washington wants peace. How would you deal with it? I have no answers.
A good question and a difficult one. My students accuse me of a multitude of sins. Waffling is not one of them. So I'm not waffling here. The problem in Washington is, how do you balance American interests with the interests of our ally Israel? So you see how the balance takes place here. President Obama will condemn Hamas. Israel is right, he says. Israel has the right to defend itself. Then in the second sentence, the Israelis are acting disproportionately. We are very concerned with civilian casualties. He has to say that because the United States has interests in the Islamic world, and those interests may be damaged, and Americans may suffer as a consequence of this.
And when the news
oil,
media...
Are you talking about oil?
Not only oil.
No, not only oil. But when the news media chops that up, Depending on which news media it is, Al Jazeera
or
Israel, they'll take one of those two sentences.
That is correct. Yeah. So the United States has different interests. Israel's primary interest is, of course, the security of its people. Now, how do you get out of the bind? In the end, this may offend some of your viewers, in the end, Jabotinsky was right.
Jabotinsky.
Okay. The Zionist, the revisionist leader. Not so much in what he wanted, a Jewish state on both sides of the Jordan. That's utopian. It's not going to be. Probably not even to hold on to all of the West Bank. But the main thing that he said was, they hate our guts. And they're going to hate our guts for a long time. What we have to do is to surround ourselves with an iron wall. Arm ourselves to the teeth. And let them charge against that iron wall. And when they see they cannot destroy it, then and only then will there be peace.
Okay. That's a good way to end the program because we are out of time.
Really, again, we just say you have a major issue, and with the professor has a half hour to explain everything to us, which should be, is written with books and statements. But in any case, Professor, thank you for being on The Jewish View, and continue the good work of teaching. And do it with good health.
Thank you,
Rabbi. So good to see you here.